The next day, the great crowd that had gathered heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." This crowd praised him. They celebrated his miracles and with great expectation told everyone about him. But they did not know him. They were waiting for someone who would rule with strength and might. But he came as a humble servant. They wanted him to finally bring their people glory, but he wanted to change them so their lives would bring God glory. They were expecting a general who would crush their enemies, but he came saying, "Love your enemies." They thought he could offer them deliverance from their oppressors, but he came offering deliverance from sin. This crowd would soon realize that Jesus wasn't gonna be what they wanted, and they turned on him before they ever realized he was what they needed. So as they yelled, "Crucify!" Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you a king?" Jesus answered, "I am not that kind of king. His kingdom isn't what you see here. It won't be established by chaos and war. His kingdom is in our hearts. His kingdom is truth. His kingdom is goodness. His kingdom is righteousness. He is the humble king, the king of healing, the king of forgiveness, the king of love. Today, we lift our voices. We cry, Hosanna, save us. Save us from our sin. Come dwell in our hearts. Hosanna, we worship you. Jesus Christ, our king."
Yes, did you get your palms when you came in? You ready to stand and wave them as we worship this morning? Won't you stand with us and we'll worship our King? Amen.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Jesus Christ, the risen one.
Good morning, Pathway. Good morning, everybody. You may be, all of you are seated, so just relax a few minutes. And I love seeing our children in action. Amen. Yes, give them a hand. One reason I love to see them, I just think about if I just had that much energy, there's no mountain, no telling what I'd do in a day. As our ushers are making preparations to come for the morning offering, I have a couple of things that I would like to share with you. First of all, so I won't forget it, let me just tell everybody for the first time that we're having a business meeting Sunday, April the 30th, Sunday afternoon here at 4 p.m. And we just have some things that we would like to share with you about a future, some future plans here at our church. And the one that we want to share with you is a new sign that we are anticipating, and we just want you to look at it and kindly get a feel of what we're planning to do, and we want your input as well. So we will be having that business meeting Sunday, April the 30th at 4 p.m. Like to remind you that we have camp meeting, New River camp meeting. It will begin here tonight at 6. Our general superintendent, Reverend Randy Carter, will be speaking tonight. The music will be provided by Free Will Chapel. Isn't that right? Free Will Chapel. Jeff Banks is the pastor there. They will be doing the music tonight. We have different speakers each night, and we will have different musicians every night. Like to also just encourage you to come to these services. It will be a good time for you to meet the new leaders of our denomination. And each night we will have a leader from our resource center that will be speaking. I need men this morning immediately after church. Men, several men, more than several men. In the fellowship hall, we want to move the round tables and fix the chairs. We will be having teen camp meeting in the fellowship hall tonight while we're having our regular camp meeting in here. At this time, we'll ask our ushers to come. Like to say we're so happy that you're here this morning to share the morning worship service with us and share your time with us, and we really appreciate you coming. If you're a visitor and you did not get a visitor's card, I encourage you to go by our desk outside, pick up a visitor's card and fill that out for us, and we have a free gift there for you as well that we would just like to share with you. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Father, this morning, we just love you and thank you for all of your blessings in life, this beautiful day that you've given us, and the very fact that we can celebrate Palm Sunday, your grand entry into Jerusalem, ready to make the ultimate sacrifice for the sins of the world. God, we thank you for this congregation today and this opportunity we have to worship you. God, we pray your blessings upon this day, upon this service, Lord, and upon this offering. God, we pray that we would be good stewards, Lord, and God, that we would use it all for the upbuilding of your kingdom this day. Again, bless this offering in the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Also, as our ushers go ahead and begin to take up the offering, you can worship with our praise team.
voices. He is alive and we are free. He is alive and we have found our peace. Our King has come.
One more time like you mean it.
He is alive and we are free. He is alive and we have found our peace. Our King has come.
Yes, God. You have come, Jesus. You have come to not only die on the cross for us, God, but next week we celebrate the risen Savior, Jesus. God, on the cross, God, we can never repay you, but we can live for you in relationship with you, Jesus. Thank you, God, for coming to earth to take our place, Lord Jesus. Thank you for your peace, God. Thank you for salvation, Lord Jesus. Thank you for restoration, God. Thank you, God, for you being sovereign in this place, God. Thank you for being sovereign in our lives, Jesus. Thank you for being on the throne, even though we can make a mess of this life and our world can be crazy, God. You are still on the throne, God. Thank you for interceding for us, God. God, sometimes we don't even know what to pray, but God, you do. You are the answer. You are always the answer, God. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you in this place. Amen.
All right. Good morning. Glad to see everyone here this morning. We will dismiss our children to go to Children's Church. If you look back there in the back, you'll see Miss Tammy in the pink. And she would be glad to escort them to Children's Church. And let's pray for them. If you will, you can go ahead and turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Mark. As you know, this morning is Palm Sunday. And it was so wonderful to see our children up here participating in our service. And almost a little bit of a reenactment of probably what we would have seen on Palm Sunday 2,000 years ago. Amen? Amen. Now, this morning, we are going to get into a message I'm very nervous about. I've had some struggle with it this week. But we're going to get into a message I call What the World Sees. Is there something I can do with this? We good? Okay. But I've got a few pictures. I am sure many of us have in our mind these images of Jesus Christ. And I've got a few pictures, and some of you may have some of these pictures in your home. But I have decided to show you a few pictures that I found on the internet of Jesus that kind of show Christ in a almost serene way. Any of you ever seen any of these pictures? Just put your hand in the air. A lot of us probably have. And when you look at these pictures, I want you to notice the long flowing hair of Jesus. In every picture, it seems like his face has a slight glow. These images are somehow created to kind of comfort us and to give us a sense of peace, and maybe they should. These images are really non-threatening. And I look at these pictures and I'm thinking to myself, who would crucify this man? Honestly. You look at these pictures and you think, well, who would crucify this man? You got a man there holding a lamb. You've got a man with just kind of staring off in the distance. And you've got one that is praying, I would assume, at Gethsemane in agony. And there's nothing wrong with these pictures per se. However, if we were only think of Jesus in terms of these images, I think we would have an incomplete picture of Jesus at best. If we were to look at these images and that would just simply be our image of who Jesus is, we would have a very incomplete picture of Jesus at best. In fact, if you were to look at Jesus during his day and we were to look at these images and think that these images, they soothe us and they comfort us, but these images really don't challenge us. But if you were to look at Jesus in his day, one of the things you would find about Jesus is he was extremely challenging. He was the same Jesus, the one that we see pictured here, is the same Jesus that said, take up your cross and follow me. This same Jesus is the one that would say to his disciples, in this world you will have tribulation. This same Jesus is one that would look to Peter and basically tell Peter that Satan had desired to sift him like wheat. And so this Jesus that we look at in these pictures, although there may be some accuracy in them, they are incomplete. And when I look at this, I find in the Scripture a man that was anything but comfortable to the religious leaders of his day and anything but non-threatening. In fact, on Palm Sunday, one of the things that we see soon after Jesus is welcomed into Jerusalem is he shows up in the temple. And Jesus is anything but calm. He is anything but peaceful. In fact, what we see is we see a Jesus who is angered by what he sees. We see a Jesus who is, the disciples described it as zealous for what was going on in the house of the Lord. And I look at that image of Jesus and I see that if we can put this together with that, then we have a full-orbed image of what Jesus Christ actually looked like. This was a man who was both sought to bring peace into our life, which we sang about, but also he told his disciples, I didn't just come to bring peace, but also a sword. And we find that in the temple, he is turning the tables over. He is running out the money changers. In fact, in Mark chapter 11, verses 15 to 18, let me read. It said, so they came to Jerusalem. Then Jesus went to the temple, began to drive out those who bought and sold in the temple, and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry wares through the temple. Then he taught them, saying, is it not written, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations? But you have made it a den of thieves. And the scribes and the chief priests heard it and saw how they might destroy him, for they feared him because all the people were astonished at his teaching. I'm going to ask Brooks if she will pray over the message.
Father God, we thank you, God, for your word, God. We thank you for your anointing and your presence here this morning, God. And I ask that we see your son the way you want us to see him, God. And then we walk out of here changed, challenged, and transformed, God. And we thank you for what you're doing in each and every one of us. Amen.
Amen. Very briefly, what I want to talk about is I just want to kind of go over what the temple was about in Jesus' day and give you some background, and then we'll get into the meat of what I want to discuss this morning. But in Jesus' day, the temple was central to the worship of the Jews of the time. Now, we read about it. Sometimes you go through it through the Scripture and you'll hear about the temple and all that kind of stuff. But the temple was built for one purpose. And it goes back all the way to Moses when the children of Israel were coming up out of Egypt. Moses is told to build this tabernacle. And in this tabernacle, God says, there I will dwell among my people. That was God's passion. That was God's desire. That was his sole reason for bringing the people of Israel up out of Egypt, is that he may dwell among his people there. That's the reason the tabernacle was built. The tabernacle was built and eventually, and you can go to the next slide if you will, the tabernacle was built and eventually Solomon comes along and builds what we call the temple. And it was based solely on the tabernacle. Now these rituals associated with the tabernacle and the temple were all intended to show the Israelites and to show the Jews how seriously God took sin. In other words, it was just a huge teaching model, a huge illustration of sin is serious. I can't allow sin to go unpunished. God is be a holy God beyond what we can even begin to imagine. And in fact, and I always fail to be able to describe God's reaction to sin. I don't know how to, except for God almost has an allergic reaction to sin. It detests him that bad. And so when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, there had to be a way for him to atone for or to cover that sin. And what the tabernacle did is it provided that way. And basically what would happen is the tabernacle was a place of sacrifice, and the temple soon took that place, and people would bring their sacrifices. And in this picture, you see the little boy with the lamb, how cute this looks. And this is a Passover lamb, and they had kept this lamb in their home for a week or so. And so that lamb had become like a pet, and they would bring that lamb to the priest, and then they would lay their head on that lamb, and the priest would take that little pet, and he would slit its throat, and the blood would spill all over the ground. And in that lesson, what was taught is that sin leads to death, and that sin deserves death. But God had provided in that lamb a way in which that sin could be atoned for and that sin could be covered. And so in laying their hand, as you can see in the second picture, in laying their hand on that animal, in essence, what they were doing is they were transferring symbolically their sin to that animal, and that animal would die in their place. And then the animal's blood would be spilled on the altar, and then the people's sin would essentially be atoned for. Now, through these, God was teaching that He had to deal with the seriousness of sin. He taught that the slaying of the innocent animal is sin has to be radically dealt with. It cannot be ignored. It cannot be overlooked. It cannot be forgotten. Now, all of us, this is the way we want to treat sin, is let's just forget about it and move on. God can't do that. It has to be dealt with. God can't just sweep it under the rug, because that doesn't deal with sin. God has to deal with it in the fact that justice, for God to be just, now God has to be loving, God has to be also just, and for God to be just, sin has to be punished. Now, all of us would not put up with this in our life, you know, we look at this and say, hey, God, you just kind of let this go. It wasn't that big a deal. Now, we wouldn't put up with that in our lives. Now, somebody steals, let's say your life savings, how many of you are going to say, oh, it's all right, no big deal, right? Don't worry about it. Or let's say that we have someone that's a rapist and a murderer, and the judge looks at him and he says, you know what? No big deal. Don't worry about it. How many would not be incensed over that? How many of us would look at that and say that is a huge miscarriage of justice? And see, God is both loving, but He is also just. And so God has to punish sin. All of us know deep down that has to happen. We just don't tend to think that our sins are that bad. Now, in reality, they are that bad. And so here God is saying, I'm going to remain just by allowing this animal to die in your place. But in that, I can also show you what? Mercy. Because you don't have to die. That's what the temple was all about. And as you look at the rituals and the practices of the temple, the people were to represent the holiness of God, the justice of God, but also the mercy of God in that He provided that substitute. And when you look at the temple itself, you can go to the next slide, you look at the temple itself, it's made up of all these different sections. And here's a close-up of the temple itself, and the most inner parts you see in there, that's called the Holy of Holies. That's where the Ark of the Covenant was. That's where the Spirit of or God Himself was supposed to come and dwell among His people. And then you look at the holy place, and that's where the priest ministered on a daily basis. And then outside of that, you've got what's called the place of sacrifice, and that's just outside the temple, and they would offer a daily sacrifice on that altar, and it was a raised platform much like we have up here, and then they would take the daily sacrifice, lay it up there, it'd be kind of like a huge grill. We would think it would look like a grill to us, and that's what they would do, and they would eat parts of that. That was the way God provided for the priest. And then you've got the court of Israel, where it was the outer court, and that's where Jewish men were allowed to come. And then you've got the court of the women. You can go to the next slide if you want to. You got the court of the women. You can see the different sections. But just outside of that, and this is where I want to go, just outside of what they call the court of the women. And you see this little, there's a little bitty wall right outside of the temple complex there. That inside's the court of women. But right outside of that is what they call the court of the Gentiles. Now, our story takes place in the court of the Gentiles, where Jesus overturns the tables, where he runs the money changers out, that takes place in the court of the Gentiles. Now, this, and you notice what Jesus said. He said, this is supposed to be a house of prayer for what? All nations. All right? Now, the Jews tended to have a very high view of themselves in Jesus' day, especially the ones that were in charge. They had a very high view of themselves in Jesus' day, and they didn't really care that much about Gentiles. In fact, a lot of times they called Gentiles dogs and all other kinds of names. And so they just thought they were a little bit step above the Gentiles. So they didn't really care much about the court of the Gentiles. So what they decided to do is they filled the court of the Gentiles with all of this marketplace. And people would travel from all over the Roman Empire on certain feast days, and they would bring with them sometimes their sacrifices, but sometimes it was such a hassle to bring your sacrifice, all, you know, maybe, I don't know, 10, 20 miles, or maybe hundreds of miles all the way to Jerusalem. So they set up this marketplace there so that people could buy their sacrifice in the temple. Now, y'all all know what it's like to go to Disney World and have to buy something to eat there, right? Or to go to King's Dominion. You know, pizza costs $12 and a drink costs $5 or whatever the case may be. Hey, it was no different in the temple, all right? People would come from all over the world and they would get to the temple and they would pay 3, 5, 10 times what a lamb actually costs to be able to provide the sacrifice that was required of them. And people were being basically hijacked. And so when people came in to this place, they had to press through all of these money changers and all these vendors. And it was all this clatter and all this noise and everything going on here. And Jesus comes on what's supposed to be one of the most holy celebrations in the time of Israel. Jesus comes. He walks up, and see, you would walk up through these holes in the floor. It was really amazing to be able to go to this place. I went to Israel several years ago, and they showed us what it would have been like, how you would walk up through the holes of this floor, and you would come out, and the light would just about blind you as you saw the skyline, and there was nothing but the temple in your sight. It was amazing sight. I can't imagine being able. But instead of being able, coming up and seeing the temple, when Jesus would come up through the floor with him and his disciples, you know what they saw? Money changers. They saw pens with doves and lambs and all that kind of stuff. And Jesus comes up and he's incensed. Now, this is the second time he's done this. All right? He is incensed. And there is where we're at here. See, what we have here is this court of the Gentiles was actually reserved. And I'm getting to my point here in just a minute, was actually reserved for the people who did not know God. In other words, the reason that court of the Gentiles was there is there were people who were not necessarily Jews, but they had an interest in God. Maybe they even believed in the God of the Bible. And they wanted to learn about the God of the Bible. And this place was reserved for those people to come and learn about the God of the Bible. But instead, when they came to worship, what did they find? They found money changers. They found people being cheated. They found people being swindled. They found people who were corrupt. They found people that instead of teaching the Bible, they found that people were being taken advantage of. Now, my point of all of that is this. If the outer court of the Gentiles is reserved for those interested in knowing about God, that is what the world sees about God. Okay? And so when these Gentiles came, did they get an accurate view of who God was? No, they didn't. Rather, what they saw is corruption. They saw people being taken advantage of. They saw a huge fair-like atmosphere going on, and there was no reverence paid to the living God. Rather than Gentiles sitting at the feet of well-learned scholars of the Old Testament learning about the God of the Bible, rather than Gentiles engaging in Psalms, maybe written 1,000 years earlier by David, rather than people coming and understanding what the temple was all about, what they saw is just a huge commotion. Now, the Bible tells us that we, the church, are the temple of God. And here's the question I want to ask you this morning. What does the world see? When the people that you interact with on a daily basis, what do they see in your life? What kind of view do they have of God when it comes to the way you live? See, we must become passionate about what the world sees in our lives and seek to drive out the sin that so encumbers us. Because here's the big point. How we live shows the world who or what we worship.
That's right. That's right.
So as the people came up through that floor into a crowd of money changers, what did it tell all the Gentile people about the Jewish leadership of that day? They didn't worship God. They worshiped what?
Money.
They were more concerned about making a dollar than accurately reflecting the character and the nature of God. Now, my question is, what does your outer court, what does what people see in your life, what does it show people, or who does it show people that you really worship? See, the noise and the clatter that filled the air on that day was a huge picture that these people didn't really worship the God of the Bible. Rather than learn about the God of the Bible, they saw corruption, they saw greed, they saw people being taken advantage of. And see, Jesus was passionate about what the people saw, in fact, and so much that it incensed him. If we aren't careful, we won't care about what the world sees. See, this is the refrain of our day. God knows what's in my heart, right? Now, we've used that to excuse all kinds of sin in our life. Now, I know I sound hard right now, but wait, I'll get easier, all right? Charles Spurgeon said it is the preacher's duty to bring the people of God under such conviction that they feel completely helpless. All right? So I'm working on that. All right? Now, I'm not trying to make you feel bad on purpose. Well, maybe I am. But the point I'm trying to make here is that God has a desire that not only what is in our heart is right, and I spoke about this a couple Sundays ago, but what people see is right. Now, here's what I want you to know. That doesn't mean you're perfect. It doesn't mean you got it all together. It doesn't mean that you never make mistakes. It doesn't mean that you completely wiped all sin out of your life. It doesn't mean any of that stuff, so don't get into that right now. But we need to care about what the world sees, just like Jesus did. Jesus got so passionate. Jesus was not passionate about what was going on inside the temple here. Jesus is cleaning out the outer court here. Jesus is passionate about what people actually see. And this is what makes him so angry, because he knows that these people have taken God and misrepresented him and ruined God's reputation among the nations. We can say sometimes, and I say this probably more than I should, is I don't care what people think. But sometimes I should. See, if we're not careful, we won't care how we treat people. If we're not careful, we don't mind leaving a sorry tip. If we're not careful, we'll rarely go out of our way to serve others unless is someone we know. If we're not careful, we don't care about making a visit or a phone call or sending a card. If we're not careful, it doesn't bother us how much people see us lose our temper or get angry for no reason. If we're not careful, we'll become more interested in making money than being honest. If we're not careful, we don't mind not coming to church or coming to church and then sleeping around. If we're not careful, it doesn't bother us if we're rude or impolite or inconsiderate. If we're not careful, we don't seem to care if we've offended someone. That's their problem. If we're not careful, we're okay with lying to people or misleading people. If we're not careful, we don't think twice about not following through on a commitment. And if we're not careful, we become more passionate about our own wants, desires, needs, and feelings rather than what God is passionate about. See, these things, I want you to understand this. These things make a huge difference in how people view God. The Bible, or not the Bible, but I read a book some time ago, and it says that every message is filtered through a messenger. Now, we carry with us the message of the gospel. What kind of filter are we? How are people viewing us? And in respect in that, how are people viewing God? See, the reason Jesus was so angry is because this was God's reputation at stake. This wasn't just that he didn't agree with them selling the lambs and the oxes and the doves. Hey, there was a place for that maybe. But it wasn't that place. He said, this is supposed to be a prayer, a house of prayer for all nations. This is a place where people are supposed to come and to learn about who God is and what God expects of their lives. And you can tell a lot about yourself and maybe even what you worship by what makes you angry, can't you? I have a long ways to go, but when some of us, when our schedule is disrupted, that makes us angry, right? Why? Because we worship comfort and convenience. And so as long as comfort and convenience is on its throne, I'm happy. But if something happens that gets my schedule off course or my comfort is disrupted, then I get angry. Someone doesn't do what we expected them to do, we get angry. I'm not saying we shouldn't, but when that anger consumes us, when we see injustice in the world, or maybe we see the lost, that should make us angry. But oftentimes that doesn't make us as angry as something that personally hurts us, does it? When we look at our lives, it's not just our inner life, but what people see, our actions, our words, our attitudes, that we are reflecting the character and the nature of God. If there aren't some areas in your life that bother you, there's a problem. That's right. See, this is the problem. This is where I want to get at right here, and this is the meat of it. All of us have some issues that we're dealing with, okay? And this is the part where you're supposed to feel better about yourself, all right? All of us have some issues we're dealing with, okay? All of us are imperfect in ways, and there are things where we haven't quite arrived yet, okay? For some of you, it may be your temper. For some of you, it may be lust. For some of you, it may be something as small as just being inconvenienced. For some of us, we may deal with what seems to be more greater sins. It may be drugs, alcohol, things like that. But all of us have the things that we deal with, the things that we struggle with. Some of us may be laziness. I don't know what your deal is, okay? Some of us, we may be selfish. But we have some things that we struggle with, all right? The problem is not that we have stuff we struggle with. The problem is, how do we respond to that? Are we nonchalant about it? Or do we not care? Or do we just chalk it up as, well, you know, God, I'm imperfect, and we just move on with our life? See, those things, listen, they are present as long as you are in this earth. There are going to be things in your life that you know aren't the right and you know shouldn't be there. It should bother you. It should disrupt you. It should cause turmoil on the inside. And this is the thing about Jesus. Jesus brings us peace, but he also brings a sword in a sense. Jesus brings us peace in that we can rest secure, that we are held in the palm of our Father's hand. But at the same time there's this tension, and that I realize I don't please Him. I realize there are ways I fall short. I realize I need to change here. I realize there's a struggle here. I realize that I've tried to do this and I keep failing time and time again. And as long as that struggle's there, and this is where I want to encourage you, as long as that struggle's there, let me tell you something, you're okay.
Come on now, that's right.
Amen. As long as that struggle is there, you're okay. But if you ever get to the point in your life where you think, hey, I'm all right, God's cool with me, and da-da-da, you need to question yourself. Because the evidence of the Holy Spirit in your life, working in your life, is that that struggle is there. That tension is there. And see, that's what Jesus came to do. As long as there is something in our life that isn't pleasing to God, He disrupts us. And He doesn't do it because He's trying to make us feel bad. The Bible says there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, but He does it because He loves us. When my son does something stupid, or my son does something, I shouldn't say stupid, but ignorant, listen, I discipline him not because I want to make him feel bad, right? Not because I want to get even. There's nothing in me that wants to get even with my two-year-old son for doing something that he doesn't know is wrong. I do it because I love him and because I care about him. I put a hand on his rim because I care, right? I don't do it just because, oh, man, you made me mad. I'm gonna hurt you now. You know, we tend to think that that's the way God is, right? Hey, I've done something to displease God. Well, I'm going to get you now. That's not, God is a loving Father. And when He does those things, He does them out of love and seeking to correct us. When He disrupts our heart, when there's something, that tension in there, we know this is where we should be, but we're not quite there. We know we struggle with this, and I know I shouldn't. Listen, that is the Holy Spirit telling us, hey, keep at it, keep working, keep struggling, keep praying, keep repenting, keep getting back up, keep moving forward, keep growing as a Christian. And I thank God for that. Amen?
Amen.
And so when Jesus is cleaning out the temple, He is creating a tremendous amount of tension in the life of the temple sacrifices, but He's doing it out of love. And until we get angry at the sin in our life, until we get frustrated enough and bothered enough to do something about it, you will never change.
Amen.
See, Pastor Tom preached some time ago about us being ambassadors, and we are ambassadors for Christ. And that's the way we need to live, is that here is the world looking at me, someone who is a Christian. I've got to accurately reflect the nature and the character of Jesus Christ. When people came to the temple on that day, they saw people being cheated. They saw people more concerned about a dollar than their brother. They saw injustice, corruption, and greed. When people look at you, they learn something about God. Sometimes a right or sometimes a wrong image. So how do you react under pressure? When people look at you under pressure, it teaches them something about God. How about when things don't go your way? When people look at you, it teaches them something about God. How do you respond when you've offended someone? This past week, I had to make a phone call, a difficult phone call. And I knew I had done something or not done something I should have done. And I'm just being honest, but I remember... Yeah, I don't know, maybe none of you have ever had to make one of these phone calls, but you know you've done something wrong, you had to make it right. Has anybody ever done that? I tried to avoid it, man. I sat with my hand like this on my front doorstep with the phone, trying to find every excuse not to make the phone call. Trying to justify. You know, I'm human, I make mistakes. To be sure they know that. Anybody ever had this conversation in your head? Walked in the house, put the phone down, done something else. Came back. I thought, gosh, if this feeling would go away, it would be awesome. I could just move on with my life, you know. But I finally made the phone call. And had to apologize and make it right. Ended up having a great conversation. But the point of all that is, I had to make sure that what that person saw was an accurate reflection of God, and that's why I was so bothered. That's why I couldn't put the phone down. That's why I couldn't just walk away from it. Now, that doesn't happen all the time. Sometimes I grow hard and callous just like we all do. But let me tell you something. When Christ is in there disrupting things, the best thing to do is submit to Him.
Amen.
So what does that lead us to? Well, a couple of things need to be avoided. When we see unjustified anger, selfishness, pride, lust, addiction, idolatry, constant strife in our life, we need to avoid two things. And these are the two things. You can move on to the next one. Hopelessness and apathy. You avoid hopelessness. In other words, don't get so down on yourself thinking, I'll never measure up, I'll never get there, God just isn't pleased with me, He'll never be pleased with me. This is where Satan would love for you to be. He would love to keep you under condemnation. He would love to keep you down and keep you separated from God and separated from God's people and make you feel horrible about yourself. And so we get hopeless. I'll never make it, right? Listen. The Bible tells us that in Philippians. It says, He which begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ, which tells me something, that God is not done with me until I see Jesus. That means I've got a ways to go. So don't get hopeless. The other mistake we make is apathy. In other words, we get apathetic, we don't care, we just assume, presume upon God's grace, and we just say, oh, God doesn't care, God understands, God will let this go, He'll just sweep it under the rug, and we become apathetic in our faith, and we don't allow the Holy Spirit to convict us, we don't allow things to bother us, and then we grow cold and calloused in our relationship with God and other people, and so we make that mistake. Hear me on this. We should be deeply disturbed by sin in our lives. We should be. We should not justify it. We should not excuse it. We should not overlook it. We should not be okay with it. But this should lead to true repentance as a lifestyle. That doesn't mean that, you know, we tend to think as a Christian, repentance is that thing I do when I get saved, right? But Martin Luther, which is one of my favorite heroes from the 1500s, when he nailed his 99 Theses on the door at Wittenberg, he said, the Christian's life is one of repentance. And the way he wrote it was continual repentance. And that means I'm confessing my sin, I'm contrite over my sin, and I'm trying to change. That's repentance. Now, with that being said, this is not easy. A.W. Tozer wrote this. He said, this mindset and the tough old miser within us will not lie down. I wish he would, don't y'all? That old man would just die, right? Well, he's dead. He's in the death throes. But it says, he must be torn from our heart, extracted in agony and blood like a tooth from a jaw. I love that because it tells me this is not an easy fight. And it's not one that's just over quickly. I wish it was. This is the second time Jesus done this. He did it at the beginning of his ministry, and he's done it at the end of his ministry. Now this time it would lead to his crucifixion. But it says he must be extracted in agony and blood like a tooth from a jaw, expelled from our soul by violence, like Christ expelled the money changers from the temple. As we seek to cleanse the outer court of our body, it is a lifetime of work for us. From now till I see Jesus, this will be my struggle. This is a daily battle through prayer, the examination of myself in the Word of God, and through the fellowship of other people that I struggle to cleanse the outer court of my temple, this body. But I keep at it. Sin must disturb me as it disturbed my Lord. It must break my heart as it broke His. It must make me angry as it made Him angry. And then He did something about it. And so I want to leave you with this challenge. Don't grow apathetic, but don't get hopeless. Amen? Keep at it. Keep struggling. Keep cleansing. Keep repenting. Keep going back to God every time you fail. Because the Bible says there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ. Every time I fall short, I have a Father that I can go to that will cleanse me. Every time I fail my wife, not only do I ask her forgiveness, but I have a Father in heaven that forgives me. Every time I fail as a father, hey, I seek forgiveness. Every time I commit a sin that I know is wrong in my heart, I must go back to the Lord in prayer and persist in my repentance. And this is the struggle that we have from now till we see Jesus. Every time I know I should do something good and I don't do it, the Bible says that is a sin as well.
That's right.
I seek the forgiveness that is granted by God. And I take sin seriously because that's what this whole temple thing was all about. Is that God took sin seriously. And He didn't just overlook it. And we do it so the same in our life. Amen? If you will, please stand. I want us to take some time and pray this morning as the, I'm going to ask the sound booth, they'll play a little music. And maybe you're struggling with something, and I'm going to be very personal with you this morning. I'm not pointing an accusing finger. Here's the thing I love about the cross. The cross is a declaration, an immaculate declaration, that all of us need help. See, not one of us in here can pretend that we're good people. Not one of us in here can pretend that we got it all nailed, that life is a breeze for us, and that I'm as perfect as I can be. See, that's what the cross says. The cross stands here in a declaration that I don't have to pretend to be somebody I'm not, because the cross tells me I'm not that good a person. The cross tells me that I ain't got it all right. The cross tells me that there are things in my life I've got to work on, right? That's the thing I love about the cross. That every one of us, Pastor Tom, myself, my wife, my child, Cameron, when we come up here to the cross, or we go to the cross, we come the same. People who need help. And that's the hope of the gospel, isn't it? And it's only that foolish individual that says, you know what, I think I can be good enough and God will love me. It's that foolish individual that says, if I work hard enough, I pray hard enough, I'm in church enough, God will accept me. The cross says, no, that ain't the way it works. There was only one good, Jesus said, and that was Him. And He became that lamb that died in our place. He became that lamb to which our sins were transferred. And so we don't have to die. He died for us. Amen? So what I want you to do this morning is I want you to come to this altar and pray with me. I'm not going to pray for you. I'm going to pray with you and bring your struggles, your frustrations, hopefully the things that you're bothered by in your own life. This is not you praying for anybody else. This is you dealing with you. And again, I've told you the cross has told everybody in here, you got something you got to deal with. Now, you can still pray at your seat. That's fine. But if you want to come to this altar this morning, I'd love to invite everyone in this room to come. And let's have that struggle this morning about what the world sees. Father, I come to You in the name of Jesus. Lord, in my own life, I know there are times I fall short. There are times my temper gets the best of me, Father. There are times I know to do good and I don't do it, Father, just like the other day. I failed at something I should have done. God, it bothered me, and I thank you, Holy Spirit, for letting it bother me like that, because it reminds me that you care and that you're still there. Father, I thank you that you've called us to yourself just like we are, that not one of us, dear God, can come to you boasting of our good works, of our performance, of how awesome we are, of how many Sunday school pens we've got, or how often we've been in church, or how many hours we spend in prayer. We can't come to you boasting about those things, God, for you have called those things filthy rags. But God, we come humbled by the holiness and the righteousness that you contain within your Godhead. Knowing that we can never measure up, Father, you've provided a way in which we could be accepted by you in Christ Jesus. God, I pray that you forgive me of my sin. God, forgive me of my laziness. Forgive me sometimes of my thoughtlessness, God. Forgive me, Lord, of my selfishness, God. I'm not just forgive me, but God, change me in this. Change my heart and change the way I act. Change what the world sees. I don't want them to see greed. I don't want them to see corruption. I don't want them to see selfishness. I don't want them to see bitterness. I want them to see God. And even in my sin, God, let me be, Lord, open enough to confess that, to seek to rectify my wrongs, God. To seek forgiveness, God. Because even in my sin, Lord, when I go and try to make it right, I am showing people the character and the nature of God. That a God, there's a God in heaven that seeks to reconcile us to himself and to one another. Lord, let me be bothered by my sin. Don't let me get away with it, Lord. Don't let me just sweep it under the rug and act like everything's okay. Don't let me grow cold and callous towards you, Lord. Lord, I see our church on the precipice of a mighty move of the Holy Spirit in the lives of our people. But it will only be preceded by us being honest and authentic before you, confessing our sin and seeking contrition and change. And God, I just ask, God, that we not have that attitude anymore. I don't care what people think, God. That is not the attitude of a Christian. When Jesus walked up through the floor of the temple gates, he saw what the world saw, and what the world saw was not an accurate reflection of God. They saw greed and corruption and people being taken advantage of, and it incensed him. It angered him. And God, I pray that there would be nothing less in our hearts against sin than anger. Oh, don't let us presume upon your grace. Don't let us just say, God, you're okay with this. Let it disturb us, but also give us the peace of the Holy Spirit, knowing that being disturbed shows us that God is with us, that he's not giving up on us. He's nudging us. He's disrupting our life. He's disturbing our heart because he loves us and he cares about us and he's trying to change us. He's not just trying to make us feel bad. So, Spirit of God, I pray that every individual in this room, including myself, especially myself, disrupt my life. Help me to change. I know there are some that say you shouldn't confess your sins. You shouldn't keep repenting again and again because you're taking the grace of God in vain. But I think it was Jesus who said, pray like this. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lord, that was a model for every prayer, which tells me that every time I kneel, I've got something to be forgiven of. Every time I kneel, I've got something to confess. It may just be a bad thought, a bad attitude, but I've got something to confess. God, this morning, if there's someone in this building that does not know you as Lord and Savior, I pray the Holy Spirit fill their heart with contrition and hopelessness until they look to Jesus and they find that hope. I ask, God, that every individual in this room that is not saved would understand that there's a God in heaven who loves them, but who cannot tolerate sin. Not because he doesn't want to tolerate sin, but because he loves us. Because he's holy. And he seeks to embrace us and cleanse us. As long as we are outside of Christ and sin dominates our life, we cannot have fellowship. And so God, out of his love, just like he built that tabernacle in the wilderness that he may dwell among his people, but he was holy, so there had to be a separation. Lord, that when Christ died, that veil was rent, that we may come into his presence clothed in the righteousness of Jesus. God, I pray that people would understand, Lord, when I talk about sin, I'm not just trying to make them feel bad, but I'm trying to get them to, Lord, to understand that this is the only way into the presence of God. And this is where God wants us, in his presence, but we must radically deal with sin in our life by accepting the brutal death and sacrifice of Christ on the cross, and then living that life of repentance before God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to tell you how much I appreciate you being here this morning, how much I love you all, and thank you for enduring my message this morning. But I hope that even though it may have made you feel bad initially, that you found some hope in it. Amen. As long as you're struggling, that's a good thing. When you stop struggling and feel like you've nailed it, it's not a good thing. Amen. Hug somebody's neck. Tell them you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord this morning.